Morning. Okay, so today we are in Luke still, and we're going to start at, let's start at Luke 21:5 and go through 11. That's a little bit more than the lectionary. No, it's not. Luke 21:5-11. That's what we'll do. And then also, if you want to tab in your Bible so that you can flip quickly with me to Psalm 96. That's a responsorial psalm today, and we're going to take a look at that too. So let's begin with the Holy Spirit prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you will renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant that by the same Holy Spirit we may be truly wise and ever enjoy his consolations. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, so we're going to start in Luke 21:5. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, "As for these things that you see, the day will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." And they asked him, "Teacher, when will this be? And what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray. For many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified. For these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes and in various places famines and plagues. And there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven." So it's very interesting to me today as I was reading this and praying through this morning and doing some research. And I was thinking about how Sarah said to me last week that the readings lately kind of scare her, that there are a lot of readings about getting ready for the judgment, and that they kind of scared her. And I was thinking very frequently when people write and ask me, you know, about a Bible study for teens and tweens, I tell them to join us in the morning because my kids are always with me. And so I'm careful to make sure that it's appropriate for teens and tweens. The irony this morning is that the kid I had in mind as I prepared for this morning went back to bed. She didn't feel good, and I sent her back to bed. So she's not even here to hear this. But I still think I want to address this fear of the judgment day, because he's talking about, you know, all these things that are going to happen before the Lord comes, and they're scary things. Among them, plagues, which, quite frankly, I don't think that anybody can argue that we've had a year of a plague, for sure. So Jesus calls us to prepare for death and judgment and heaven and hell, those last four things, right? And to be aware and to always be ready, always be ready. And that's been the theme of all these last few weeks leading up to the beginning of the new liturgical year. This is the end of the liturgical year, and a reminder over and over again to be ready, always be ready. And we're in the midst right now of some of the things he's talked about. And in a big sense, like the plagues and the wars and the insurrections and all those things are happening or have happened recently. But Jesus tells us not to be terrified. Like in my translation, I'm reading from the NRSV right now. It says, "Do not be terrified." Straight up, in the middle of listing all these things, he says, "Do not be terrified." He lists these things specifically so that we know that they're coming and we can still be at peace, like not lose our peace, because we should not be terrified. We should not be terrified of these things. We should not be terrified of the judgment as long as we don't have false idols. As long as God is God and we leave him in his place. If we're firmly rooted in the word, if we're firmly rooted in following him, if how we conduct our lives is in step with the gospel, then whatever happens today or any day won't break us. We should not be terrified. We can stand firm without fear. He says so. He says, do not be terrified. So I love that the responsorial psalm today, that in the liturgy at today's Mass is Psalm 96, because I think that this was brilliant. And it really addresses this whole idea of not having false idols, and that the false idols are who terrify us or what terrifies us. And we let them because we let them in. So let's, I'm going to read Psalm 96 and we're going to talk about that a little bit. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. For he is to be revered above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols. But the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord glory, do his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord is king. The world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the people with equity. Let the heavens be glad and the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. So if we are walking in step, then all this singing, this exalting is ours. If we are in step with God, if we are on guard against the false idols, all of this is ours. The time of judgment is not something to fear. We should move from day to day, sure of his salvation and declaring his glory. So the gods that are idols are imposters and pretenders. And they're the ones that Jesus warns us about in Luke 21:8, which I don't think I, there we go. You know, where he says, beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, I am he. I think it's important that we recognize what the idols are in our lives, that this is a call to ask God to make very clear what we are propping up as a false idol, as a false god, what we are idolizing as a false god. Because we have nothing to fear as long as we are not following a false god. And what are those false gods? They are so many things. And it's important to think about what you idolize. The things that come to mind readily and we talk about all the time are idolizing money or idolizing power or prestige or accolades. And sure, those are definitely false gods. But what are some other things that we can idolize? Can we idolize our sense of family? Do we have an idealistic perception of what our house should look like, how we are affirmed? Can we idolize a relationship even? You know, are we serving not out of love, but in order to be rewarded or revered or respected? All those things are idols. The idea of human respect and doing something in order to gain it is an idol. And I think that as we you know, most of us are heading into a holiday where the demands on women are generally more. And the bar gets raised, what's being expected of you gets raised. But I ask you to think about who you're serving. Is this for Jesus? And know that if you're serving out of love, it's good enough for Jesus. And that takes away the idol of, you know, whether it's Pinterest worthy, whether it's peaceful according to human peace. If everything is framed in light of the gospel, then we've successfully removed the idols in our lives and we've looked at, what does God want? Can I get up in the morning, offer the whole day to God? Everything that's going to happen, every response I make, everything for the good, every hard thing, just offer the whole thing to God. What does God want? And stay in step with Him. And then we don't fear judgment, and we don't fear death, and we don't fear life either. And I think that's it. I think a lot of us go through life with this low-grade anxiety where we're fearing life. And we don't have to. Jesus says we don't have to. He says, do not be terrified. We should be living in a way that we grow day by day in maturity and righteousness and truth. That's the goal. His righteousness, His truth, and none of those that we idol. And so when you have a day that seems like a struggle, I think it's really important, like in the midst of it, to try to remember to ask God to let you see what false idol it is that's causing you to be distracted from truth. So the day is a struggle and it's getting out of hand, and you just stop and put yourself in the presence of God and say, okay, this is not of you. I know this is not of you. What is the false God I'm worshiping right here, right now, that's causing me so much stress in the middle of this day? Help me to see it and help me to take it away so that you are the only God in front of me today. All right, so that's my pre-holiday pep talk. Couple of things. I talked about A Radiant Dawn yesterday, and I told you that it was $11 at Amazon, and I promise you that it was when I checked, but whatever gremlins there are out there in the Amazon world, they heard that we want to do this, I guess, and they bumped the price up to $20. So, still a great book. But I've told you it was $11. So what we're trying to do is get a digital version up for you today. And it'll be $10. So, it's not the same. We know that it's nice, especially with this book. It's really nice to be able to put the notes in the book. Because there are lots of like keep yourself on track notes. But you'll be able to print out those journaling pages, and we'll make it work best we can. Or you can buy it for $20, and I'd be so grateful, because we are trying to keep this ministry going and we do need some money to do that. But we're working on it, is my point. We're still gonna do it. We're still gonna just study both Essential Holiness and A Radiant Dawn. We're gonna have an awesome Advent. So it's at Amazon, and as of right now, it's $20. Sometimes when there's a buying flurry, they'll bump it down again a little bit. So I don't know. That's best I can tell you. So that's the plan. As of right now, I will be here tomorrow at 9 o'clock, as usual. My boys are driving home tomorrow in the morning. I'm not sure when. So I may shift the time around after I figure out what time they've left Virginia and what time their expectation is. So we'll see. I don't know. But right now I'm planning to be here tomorrow at 9 and then Thursday at 7:30. So up in time to remind you to get that turkey rolling. Actually, I have no idea. I don't cook the turkey. Turkey's not my thing. But I'll be here at 7:30 on Thursday, and then I think at 9 tomorrow morning. And if it's not going to be at 9, we'll put a note up and let you know what time we're going to shift it to. But we're going to stay faithful. We're going to stay in this word. And we are going to be sure that we put God right in front of us so we're not idolizing anything else through this whole holiday weekend. So go do your day. Thanks for being here, and we'll see you tomorrow.